hey there, Alga Talkers. Welcome back to the Alga Talk Studios. I know it's been a long time since we've had a talk here, since we've talked about algae. And now we've had a sort of a tough year. I'm sure everybody understands. I apologize. I'm sure everybody's had their sort of corona situation. Hopefully we're trying to get out of that. So I've actually moved to a new location and we put together this new AlgaTalk Studios. You'll see later on in this intro how we're doing it. And we're gonna do more stuff with YouTube, with the YouTube channel, and try to get more videos, AlgaNews, some fun stuff, maybe some reaction videos, exploring, and of course the podcast. We have a lot of older stuff that we still have to go through. I'm sure if people are following AlgaTalk, I'm sure you know who you are, that we haven't put out a podcast yet. Like we said, it's a tough year, but it's been a tough year for everybody with the corona. So we have a whole new sort of setup, and we're going to see, we're going to have the older podcasts first start to come out. We're going to start to do videos on YouTube channel, AlgaNews, sort of what's coming up, what's been during that month or in the past few years, or interesting research or stories, or just funny things that are just interesting about algae. As we keep going, we're going to have more podcasts, so keep looking up. We're going to have more interviews, newer stuff. To start us off, we have a podcast that I am editing right now that is with Eunice Boundir, who's the founder of Seaweeds of Morocco. And we have a podcast where we talk about all the different things that he has to harvest the seaweed off the coast and has to have to dry it and sell it to the public. So he talks a lot about the communications, also how do you relate algae to the public? I'm sure a lot of people have questions about that. That's still a major question about algae, but we're getting out there. And the more that we push, the better. So without further ado, I'm gonna have to get back to this podcast and finish editing it. But I'm gonna see you guys right over there in the corner that you can't see right now. But you guys will see in a bit that we're gonna have our first AlgaNews, and we're gonna talk a little bit about the podcast that's gonna come out soon. I'll see you over there. So let's get back to the Alga Talks. AlgaNews. I'm Jack, and this is AlgaTalk's new studio. I'm here to go over some of the recent articles that have come up and some fun things, and we're going to start the month of June with some interesting news about cows. I think some people, if you're already into algae, you kind of know cows very much, if they're hungry, will actually graze on seaweed. As we can see here and here, they're big grazers, and the algae research now is trying to look into whether or not algae can help cows burp less. And basically their burping comes from the way that they eat, that they're ruminants, and that basically they belch methane. And this methane is part of the problem we have with climate change, and it's one of the gases that is in the climate that's affecting and making the temperature go up. And this is kind of some of the issue that they're trying to go through. We have a recent article on the 14th of May, 2021, talking about how seaweed for cows can combat global warming, like we talked about. And it basically, it's trying to figure out how can we do this. There's a lot of questions about this this thing. Some of the interesting things about this research is it's been done mainly kind of out of Australia. This kind of red algae called Asparagopsis. So this red algae contains bromoforms with a halogen compound which is known to inhibit the methane within their stomachs that they're eating. So they basically add this to the food of the cattle, and as you can see from one of the things here, about 3% cuts down on their methane by 80%. So this could be a real game changer if enough cows were able to eat this and we were able to cut down on the methane around the world. Just a little bit about me. I used to work actually in a dairy farm, and you can see that they have a lot of room for algae to go in there. And basically, this is the Asparagopsis, red algae, obviously, red seaweed. And there are some problems with this research. Of course, it's early on in the research, about 5 years around that going on, maybe even less. And so there's some problems. It turns out the cows are not big fans of the fishy sort of seaweed taste that some of us love. And so maybe we have to try to figure out how the cows will ingest it, maybe actually want to eat it. Also, this algae, you'd have to grow it. I mean, we're thinking about how much cows are in production. There's a huge amount of cows. How can you get this algae to all the cows? Which is a bit of a problem, because then maybe you're over harvesting, or you're bringing this algae into areas you shouldn't be growing it. So it needs to be harvested in the correct place with the regulations to be able to do this correctly. Now, also one of the things is that basically the researchers, they're now investigating whether the meat and the milk, which is the most important parts that we get out of cows, they're trying to figure out whether or not this could be actually harmful to humans, because there are some toxin buildups because of the seaweed enhanced diet. So we're gonna probably maybe have this again on AlgaNews. Like I told you, I'm a big fan of cows and used to work in a dairy farm, so kind of miss these guys, and hope maybe we can figure out how to help with climate change with algae. The next thing that I want to talk about is the podcast that hopefully will be coming out soon about Seaweeds of Morocco. I spoke with the founder of Seaweeds of Morocco. This is actually some of their seaweeds that they harvest. I talked to Eunice Bundir, and basically we go over basically his personal experience with dealing with harvesting seaweed in Morocco. So just some things I thought were very interesting when I was learning about Seaweeds of Morocco. The main place that they harvest is El Jadida, which is right about here on the Atlantic coast. So you could see, you know, algae and stuff is sort of washing up here. And for a long period of time, they've been harvesting it. A lot of the women go out and harvest it where it's up close in the coast. And of course, the men go out and go for diving for this. You can see the red seaweed right here. They basically bring it out, dry it, and the rest. I just want to sort of go over some interesting points that I found. That they actually collect this seaweed, the red seaweed, different kind. 3 months of the summer, so basically the entire summer, they're going along this coast and basically picking it up. And the red seaweed is used to produce agar. Agar is a major product that is able to be used. A lot of scientists use it in their pastry dishes. A lot of people actually add it, a lot of companies add it to ice creams. It's a good thickener. It has a, sort of a lot of fattiness to it. It's a gelatin. It's a vegan gelatin that, as you know, algae is a plant, so everybody can enjoy it, which is actually very important for certain religious groups and people that are vegans, to be able to still have, you know, that sort of fatty, gelatin-y taste that we all like. The problem is that within Morocco, this has been harvested for a long period of time, and it's basically over-harvesting this red seaweed that's actually called galidium. I don't know if I'm spelling it right, so I'm just going to point it out. Galidium, and this red seaweed has been sort of over-harvested to the point that you can see here, Morocco was a key exporter until 2006 when it was overtaken by China and Chile. I'm not too sure if that actually has to do with the over-harvesting. I think it does. Because in 2010, Morocco fixed the reference price at 3.25 dirhams. I'm not too sure what that is, 30 euro cents. And so basically setting it up so that it can't be over-harvested and that the prices keep increasing over time. So trying to cut down on, I guess, inflation of the price so that it would be too expensive, but still. We talk about on the podcast, which I think are very interesting, and I thank Eunice for doing that. And we talk about a lot of how the government has to be a part of this. Like we can see, Morocco is starting to do that here. We talk about this overall. It's a very personal journey with him about how he harvests and when he harvests and basically his love of Morocco and seaweed. And so basically be looking out for that, and that will be coming out soon. On to our next thing. I'm very interested in this one. This is about algae helps the blind to see. Now, basically, this is an article that came to my attention from a fellow alga enthusiast. So we can see here about algae proteins partially restored man's sight. This was on the 24th of May. Very interesting article, I very much suggest that you guys look it up. It was from the BBC. Right up there, and it just it really shows the importance of algae and algae research as we move forward. Just some points that I really thought were very interesting about this. So the man that is blind has a retinous, I'm gonna try my best to say this, a retinous pigmentosa. So you can hear from the name of it that it's got pigment, so it has to do with colors, of course, how the eyes see color, which leads to the death of light-sensing cells on the surface of the retina. So you can understand how algae research could possibly help in this area. The technique was based on the proteins produced in the alga. I'm going to try this again. Channel rhodopsins. Channel rhodopsins. So these rhodopsins were taken from the algae and given to the cells in the back of the surviving layers of the retina, where sort of light is sort of translated by the brain. And he wore he wore goggles. Just show this is sort of how the rhodopsins. How the light is coming into the eye, and how it basically uses these different spectrums of the light to be able to help the person see. So as you can see here is the picture of how this thing works, that he's got, you can see right here, the goggles on, and he's basically trying to see the cup. So you can see right here, he has some kind of computer system, and it's hooked up, and he's got goggles, and it's projected into the back. So, you know, it's very early on in the research. It took months for this one patient to be able to actually start to be able to see. And it's very interesting how algae can, with its photosynthesis and be able to define light, to be able to show someone how to be able to see. It's really an advance in science, and sadly, because of the pandemic, they've only been able to do it with one person, but from the article, they are planning on doing a lot more research into this. And talking about how algae saves, continuing with how algae saves, for our next segment, it's our FICO fun moment, and we're going to continue talking about how algae helps people. In this scene of Jaws, algae is going to help and save Richard Dreyfuss's character, and let's see how it happens, okay? Alright, so he's trying to get stab Jaws at some point. I don't think Jaws is going to like any of that. There he is! Yep, he's not liking any of that. Doesn't want to get stabbed with poison. Not interested. Alright, drops down. He doesn't have the poison anymore to get Jaws. And it's down at the bottom of the sea floor, where the algae is. And if you figured it out, we'll see. See if he figures it out. He's trying to get out. He's got to find somewhere to hide from Jaws. Still can't get down there. Go. And there's Jaws. Yep, and he's gone. And where does he go? Where is Richard? Well, Jaws is going crazy. Have we lost Richard Dreyfuss? Have we lost him? No! He figured out to hide in the kelp. That's right here. Let's see right here, he's hiding in the kelp bed. Yeah, in the kelp forest. With all the fishies that are probably hiding away from Jaws as well. Richard Dreyfuss hiding out the Jaws fight in the kelp forest. I mean, that's algae saving you in the nick of time. So that's your FICO fun moment. So just remember, if you're ever in a cage, yep, if you're ever in a shark cage and you get out of it and you're trying to hide away from a shark, find some kelp forest, hide in there. I think Jaws was made out of a lot of acid sandstone. It's very interesting. Well, that's our algae news. We'll see you next time. Click subscribe and hit that notary bell, and then you'll get the newest episode of Alga News as we keep going. We're going to follow some of the algae news, some of the old algae news. It's going to be a variety, and just like algae, it's going to be diverse. We'll see you there. Bye.